Good morning, everyone. Today's lecture is on die systems and materials. So by the end of the lecture, you should be able to define what is a die and outline the die materials. Then what is the selection criteria to prepare a die. Then compare and identify what are the various die systems and what are their advantages, disadvantages and indications for each category. So to introduce, you know that fixed partial dentures have been evolved over a period of time and the evolution from the removable partial dentures to fixed partial dentures including implants moved at a very high rate, and today we are at a point that patients would prefer to have a fixed partial denture rather than have a removable partial denture. And how do we definitely know that your fixed partial denture can be accurate? So as people have been working and bringing their thoughts on how accurate your fixed partial denture can be, there were different kinds of ideas that people have come up with, and the different kinds of systems that they've been using. And so one among them, and which is even used as of now, if you're doing a conventional fixed partial denture, that is like with the help of casting, and even if you're doing printing, metal printing as well, definitely dies and the preparation of a die is very important. And as we go through the lecture, you will understand what is this die and what are the different die systems are about. So to define, a die is basically a positive reproduction of the prepared tooth, and it consists of a suitable hard substance of sufficient accuracy, that is improved stone, metal or resin. And by definition, working cast is a replica of the prepared teeth, the ridge areas and other parts of the dental arch. So this is how the definition goes like. So what are the requirements of a working cast? So what is a working cast? As I mentioned earlier, so once you have finished your tooth preparation, you make a definitive or the final impression with the help of an elastomeric impression material, and then you obtain a cast that is called your working cast, right, on which you are going to prepare your fixed partial denture. So your working cast, which you are going to make an impression, it should have and replicate both the prepared tooth, that is your crown prep, and the unprepared tooth structures as well. So the unprepared teeth adjacent to the preparation definitely must be free of voids. And the anterior teeth, suppose if you're preparing anterior teeth, it should involve anterior guidance, and all the occlusal surfaces should allow precise articulation with the opposing teeth. So this calls our attention that when we have poured a cast and we have removed it from the impression, the first thing that you have to do is have a keen observation on the cast and analyze the cast if there are any blebs of dental stone or die stone or any kind of extra material that has grown. So all of these have to be carefully removed from the cast, and your cast must be prepared and it should replicate and look exactly like how the hard tissues are there in the oral cavity. And the relevant soft tissues also should be covered. Suppose if you're doing a 3-unit or a 5-unit bridge, so in those cases the edential space where the soft tissue covers the residual ridge, that also has to be recorded properly, because that determines the kind of a ponting that we are going to give and the design which we are going to allow for the ponting. So what are the requirements for die preparation? All surfaces must be accurately duplicated. No bubbles or voids can be accepted. All the details of the prepared tooth, that is your finish line, all the axial preparation, the proximal preparation should be reproduced. Then the unprepared tooth surface immediately cervical to the finish line. So your finish line demarcates the prepared tooth structure and the unprepared tooth structure. So this also has to be accurately produced in your die in order to allow the technician to identify where the finish line ends in the wax pattern, or otherwise this will give you a false finish line and hence your crown is overextended and it impinges on the marginal gingiva. Then adequate access to the margins is necessary. So what are the basic requirements of die materials? So the die, you have seen what are the requirements of a die, but to form the die you have different materials, and these materials, before we discuss what these materials are, you should know that this die material should have accuracy, dimensional stability, it should be smooth and hard surface, but which will not be abraded easily. It should be compatible with impression material, should have high strength, should have good color contrast, it should be economical, should be easy to manipulate, and also have the ability to produce fine details and sharp margins. And now you see what are the different materials that are used for die fabrication. You have gypsum products, then you have amalgam, then you have cements, then you have polymers and film polymers, then you have electrodeposition of material of metals, that is your copper plated die or your silver plated die. Then you have your metal spray dies, flexible die materials, and also refractory materials for the die preparation. So if you are asked what are the materials used for die fabrication, this is a very important 2-mark question. This is what you have to keep in mind. So what are the two die systems that we have? You can either use a working cast with a separate die and or a working cast with a removable die. So now as you look at this picture, you see that there are three casts, right? So there is one master cast, there's that the final cast, and there's one more cast you see in additional, that is a separate die, that is meaning that area in the impression where which is going to remove the fixed partial denture is poured and separated, right? So you prepare the wax pattern on one die, on your separate die, and then you try it on the master cast and see for the accuracy and the fit. So that is the difference. And whereas working cast with a removable die, I'm going to in detail discuss how the different systems are used and how the die is prepared. So working cast with a separate die, in this as I mentioned earlier, so two casts will be poured from the single impression. So once you made one impression, you will be having one master cast, you keep it aside, and one cast, again what you're going to do is the entire section where you're going to prepare the fixed partial denture is separated and it is sectioned. Okay, so once the wax pattern is prepared on this sectioned cast, it is then transferred to the other working cast and checked for the accuracy. So in this kind of die system, there are advantages and disadvantages. So suppose if you look at the advantages, it's very simple, it's easy, more accurate, it's easy to obtain the contours, then you have an intact gingiva, no special equipment is also required, and no errors of seating. But whereas the disadvantages are that once you have formed the wax pattern on this die and you want to move it to the working cast, in this process you might distort the wax pattern. So whatever hard work you have put in to make the wax pattern, while transferring to the working cast, it might be distorted. And sometimes the separation between the two proximal areas can be more, so the proximal margins tend to get over contoured. And next, coming to the die preparation, so the die is a single replica of the prepared tooth structure, right? So it is first prepared on the model itself, and then once the die has been sectioned, each tooth is taken out and the handle is slightly prepared, it is polished so that it facilitates easy placement and removal on the cast, right? So the handle should be around 1 inch long, and as you notice on this picture below, Below the prepared tooth structure, an acrylic burr, a pear-shaped burr, or a large round burr is used to prepare the unprepared tooth structure. So this helps in demarcating and defining the finish line in the die. So, and once the finish line has been obtained, that is called as ditching. So under this line you see a concave surface which is called as ditching, and which you are going to do it with your large round burr and a small or a small round burr, depends on the cast that you are going to prepare. So once that has been prepared, this finish line has to be marked with an indelible red colored pencil. So this marks the finish line, and this helps the technician, because your entire die is prepared with the same colored material. Suppose if you are let's say that we are using gypsum products. So if you are using gypsum products, the entire cast will be of the same color. And then once the line finish line has been marked, the next thing that you have to do is use a hardening agent, which is mainly either cyanoacrylate or acrylic resin lacquer. It can be applied on the finish line and the areas of a die to prevent abrasion, because every time you're going to place the wax pattern and you're going to take it out, or once the wax pattern has been casted and you receive your metal coping, you're going to meddle with the instruments also on the working die. So what happens is, because of the tendency of this material, suppose especially if you're using a dental stone or the gypsum products, so this tends to scrape off the material. So in those cases you have to use a die hardening agent. So what are the advantages of having a die like this? It is the simplest means of fabricating a working cast. It also keeps the relationship of the abutments fixed and immovable. And method of accurately orienting the preparation models to each other, which is considered important. Then the gingival tissues are and other landmarks are intact. It is easier to obtain physiologically harmonious restorations and also contours when the wax pattern is being fabricated. The other disadvantages is that procedures are quite difficult. To encounter poorly seating dies and dowels, sometimes you have a difficulty, a little bit of changes. The position of the die might vary, so the entire FPD might be a failure. Difficulty in cutting the die or preparation of the die with the saw, and interproximal margins can also be easily damaged. So what are the requirements of this removable die system? The dies must return to their exact original position, and they must be stable, and even when inverted also, that is when you are turning the cast, and the cast containing the dies must be easy to mount on a articulator. So that, because occlusion is the main concept, and at ultimately whatever crowns that we are going to replace or we are going to fabricate, it should definitely have the stability. So working cast with a removable die, when you are going to do this, we have two techniques, that is your pre-pour technique and your post-pour technique. So in your pre-pour technique, most of the impression that you're going to use for preparation of the die will be coated with the dental stone or any of the gypsum products or any other material, and in which the die fins will be oriented, and that will be used as your die model. But post-pour technique is where you have already used the impression to pour a definitive cast, and that cast is subjected to different kind of procedures so as to make the die preparation. So what are the different die systems that we are going to read about? Straight double pin, curved double pin, pin-deck system, and the die lock tray. So if you look at the straight double pin, this is how it is going to look at. So the straight double pin will be immersed into the material, the gypsum products, and it will be secured in that position where the prepared tooth structure is. So this is how, once you have obtained your impression, this is how your impression looks like. And if you notice that the double pins are secured in that area where the tooth is prepared. So once you remove the impression from the patient mouth, you have a look at it, and you know that which are are the areas where the teeth have been prepared. So in that area, you help to secure the double pin, the straight pin, with the help of bobby pins. And once the bobby pins have been secured, and you know that they are not moving, so that is when you start pouring the impression. So so additional paper clips are also used to secure this. And once the first pour has been poured into the impression, and you know that your double pins are secure in their position, then the second pour must be used. And so unless the first pour is set, you should not be removing the paper clips, so or these bobby pins that you are going to use. So once this the impression material is gypsum product is set, that is when you are going to pour the second pour of the stone. So after the stone has been poured, and once the stone has been set, what you have to do is there must be a small filler that is placed in the lingual surface, or that is of your impression, so that when you are going to take out your stone model and you are going to trim that, these fillers that we are going to use on the double pin, they will be exposed, and you know that that is where your double pin is located. So as you notice this picture, you will see that there is wax at the end, right? So once this flat surface of the impression or of the cast is trimmed, these wax patterns or these filler materials will be exposed, and then this wax has to be removed, and with the help of an instrument, you will push the dye out. So and how do you separate the dye? Then you, with the help of a saw, you section the die like this into different components on the main cast, and that is how the entire die comes out from the cast. So after the dies have been separated, so like this, with the help of an instrument from the base of the cast, you will use this instrument to push the die out, and this helps in loosening the die, and it removes the die from the cast. So next thing is the base of the die, once it is removed. So as I mentioned earlier, you've been told about ditching. So below the finish line, without damaging the margin, you should use a round burr and finish and prepare the unprepared tooth structure. So this helps in defining or making sure that the finish line is very prominent, and the technician will be able to differentiate where the finish line is ending. Sometimes your impression might not record clearly where the finish line is ending, so that is why you will have to do the ditching. So once it has been prepared, then you can again seat the die back on the cast, and this is how your die is going to look like. This is about how the straight double pins are used. So once again, to just brush up, as you see this picture, this is how your impression is going to look like. First, the double pin is secured. Then the first pour, this is your pre-pour technique, right? So you pour the first pour of your dental stone, then separating media is applied, and then second pour is applied. So that is why, unless you have applied the separating media between the first pour and the second pour, you will not be able to remove this die from the cast. So hence, separating media is very important. After the cast is set, then the dies are sectioned by placing the vertical sections in the interproximal regions, and then this base is trimmed, and with the help of an instrument, the die pins are pushed, and then your die as a single unit, it will come out of the cast. Next one is your curved double pin. So the curved double pins also can be incorporated into the working cast by fixing these doubles into the impression before the impression is poured, just like how we have done the straight double pin. And what we can also do is, you can first pour it, make holes, drill holes into the cast, and then insert these curved double pins. So as you see, so the cross section, this is how your impression looks like. You can make out that the impression is there, and the pin is curved in relation to that area where the prepared tooth structure is there, and So this is your pre-pour technique. So you section it first with the help of bobby pins, then you pour the first pour, and once that has been set, you remove the bobby pins and then pour the second pour. So what can also be done is that depressions can be made 2 mm deep on either side of the dowels into large segments of the cusp. Then that will carry the unprepared teeth also. So not only near the fixed partial denture preparation area, but on other sides as well, you will have to you will have to place the dowel pin. So when you turn the cast and place it on a flat area, your cast should be parallel to the surface where you have placed it, right? Then also you have to notice that a thin layer of petroleum is applied on the stone and the dowels like this. Then what you can also do is boxing wax to secure and to make sure that your dental stone or the gypsum product will not overflow. By boxing the impression, you will confine the gypsum products to the particular impression itself, and it will not pour out and it will not come up. And so once it has been done, you can use a saw and section that particular area. And from once the sectioning has been done, that section can be removed by pressing or exposing the tip of this curved dowel. And when you are going to push that curved dowel pin easily, as you notice in the picture, the die with the curved dowel pin will come out. Next is your Pindex system, and this is the most used, commonly used system. And in this, what we are going to do is we are going to take the impression, pour the cast properly, and once the cast, the die stone cast or the model has been set, remove it, trim it properly, even including the palatal surface, and all the edges have to be polished properly. And this cast will be secured on a machine, on a drilling machine. As you see, I will show you in the next picture. So you pour the cast, you trim it on the model trimmer, and this is how your cast should look like. And you see that on the first quadrant, 3 units bridge, it is prepared. So once it has been trimmed properly on the model trimmer, and also you should make sure that the entire base of the cast should be at least 15 mm in height, and then the palate area also should be trimmed. So why do we trim the palate area? That is why I would like to also emphasize and let you know, even when you are doing your FPD impression, suppose if you are preparing a tooth on the upper arch, that is your maxillary arch, we would suggest that you can do the impression with the help of a lower tray on the upper arch, because while doing the die preparation, you are anyways going to eliminate the palatal area. You do not need the palate of the area to be recorded, because you are anyways going to section it, section the die. So hence the palate area has to be removed, and once that entire area has been removed, you will see this is how your die, your working cast is going to look like. So hence it is important. And once the cast is obtained, so this is your Pindex system, and you place it on the machine, and you see that the black handle, you will have a laser light that is focused on the prepared prepared tooth structure. So you have to make sure that this laser falls exactly on the central fossa of the occlusal surfaces of the posterior teeth, or on the cingulum seat on the anterior teeth, and that is where exactly your laser light needs to be focused. And once the laser light has been focused, from below a drilling pin would come and make a drill directly. So this is how your laser will be focused, okay? And once the laser has been focused like this, in this way, you have to ensure that the cast is stable. So you have to hold it properly, that your laser dot could fall exactly on the occlusal surface. So once it has been focused, from underneath a drilling machine would come and make pinholes like this. So once the pinholes have been made, you have to use a three-way syringe, blow up that area, make sure that all the the stone, the powder that has been accumulated because of the removal of the stone in that area must be dried up. It should be brushed out completely, and always ensure that when you are making the pinholes, that your cast should be completely set, and it should not be in still a setting stage. So the cast will be having the die pins like this, and once that has been removed, what you're going to do is, with the help of cyanoacrylate, you're going to immerse your double pin into cyanoacrylate and place it and position it in the pinholes that you have made with the help of the Pindex system. So the cyanoacrylate is placed on the pin and it is secured, and in, as you see in this picture B, your pins are secured in the cast. So once the cast, the pins have been placed, you have different sleeves. So plastic sleeves are placed on these pins again, because we are again going to pour a base on this area. We are going to pour the base of the cast. So when you're pouring the base of the cast, if you want your die along with the double pin to come out easily without any kind of a lubrication or destruction of the cast around it, what you've got to do is place sleeves around this double pin, so which will help you in easy removal of your die and replacing it again back on the cast. So this is how you secure it, with the help of sleeves. And after placing the sleeves, what you're going to do is apply separating medium or petroleum jelly all around the doubles and on all the surface of the cast. So once the petroleum jelly has been applied, what you got to do is, at the end of each double pin, you have to block it with the help of a utility wax. So the end of all your double pins will be blocked with utility wax, and after that, what you're going to do is, you're going to do the beading and boxing, or with the help of a base former, you are going to make the base for the working cast. So this is how your cast is going to look like. So you will fill the base former with some stone, and you immerse the cast, and you have to ensure that the base of this cast is touching or coming in contact with the dental stone that you have poured in the base former. So there should be an intimate contact, so that your dental stone or your of the base and your die stone of the prepared and the unprepared tooth structure, that is your cast, come in contact and they set together. So that is how your cast looks like. In picture A, you see that there is a base that is formed, and once your base has been formed, what you got to do is, you can mark the areas which are supposed to receive the fixed partial denture. You are going to section them with the help of a saw blade, like how you have done in the earlier systems also. And after that, the base of the cast has to be trimmed on a model trimmer. So when you are trimming on the model trimmer, what happens is, some amount of the base is removed, and the wax that you have used to secure or close, the utility wax that you have used to close the double pins at the base, will be exposed, and that wax has to be carefully removed, and a condenser can be used to loosen up the dies. So once the wax is removed, you can loosen up the die, and then this condenser will help you to remove your die from the working cast. And that is about your Pindex system. And next one is your die lock tray. So die lock trays are something unique and different apart from your impression techniques, your pre-pour technique, your post-pour technique, and all of that. It's a little difficult, but in your die lock tray system, you don't have so much of lab procedures. Once your impression has been poured and your cast has been poured, a snap plastic tray, as you see in the picture, which will have an internal grooving and notches, can be used. They will be of different sizes, and this the cast can be seated upon this, and this die lock tray itself, it will help in reassembling the working die and the working cast and the die. So, what are the advantages of the dialoguing system? It is accurate, and since it is already sectioned, you do not have additional work to do. Trimming is not required. The trays can be reused, and pins are also not required. And once the impression has been poured, your die system is already ready. But what are the disadvantages is that it is time consuming. It can also require some amount of cast trimming to accommodate the width of the arch. So the cast that you have got from your impression might not exactly fit in the kind of the size, the size of the tray that you are going to have. So sometimes there must be amount of trimming that is required, and definitely you have to index which tooth you are going to place, and because that will help in identifying your die. So that is a disadvantage. So as you see, we have poured the impression, and that is your dialogue. So that is inverted into the dialogue tray, and once the dialogue tray, the base is removed, and you just have got to use the instrument to just remove the underneath the tray. And once it has been removed, the sectioning, it is already the indexing is already done. So you have to just follow the indexing and just section it, and this is how each tooth on your cast can be separated. So this is how your dialogue tray system is going to look like. So I would suggest that dialogue tray would be a good option if you're doing a full mouth rehabilitation, where each of your prepared tooth structure, all the teeth prepared, are going to receive crown. So in that case, this might be an easier system rather than using a pin deck system. So to summarize, I hope you were able to understand what is the difference between the working cast and the die. So your working cast is, you have two types, your working cast with a removal die or a working cast with a fixed die. So that is one thing. The different die materials, your gypsum products are the most commonly used die materials. And next is your die preparation. So with your separate die and with your removal die, I hope you are able to understand. With the separate die is that you are making a section only of that prepared tooth structure area, and whereas your working cast with a removal die is the same impression, same cast, you are going to use a saw, section those areas and get the die removed, that is with the help of different die systems, that is your dialogue tray, straight double pin, curved double pin, and pin deck system. Pin deck system is the most commonly used, and the dialogue tray is also the most commonly used if you're doing multiple restorations in this. Yeah, so I hope you were able to understand everything about the dialogue tray systems, the pin deck system, what is a die, what is the cast, working cast, non-working cast, all of this. And if you have any doubts, you can get back to me. Thank you.